Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ and Him crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So wrote St. Paul in 1 Corinthians. Greeks seek wisdom. And at the time of St. Paul, there was plenty of it on offer. You had Socrates and Plato and Aristotle and all them other highfalutin Greeks. And those were considered the smartest cookies in the jar. In an apparently chaotic world, these philosophers searched for some signs of order. Early attempts began with the basic elements, earth, air, fire, and water. Then Plato taught that the things of this earth were copies and shadows of the ultimate things in the realm of ideals. Aristotle added to this framework, concluding that this was a world of cause and effect. If this, then that. And in the time of Martin Luther, Renaissance scholars were rediscovering the writings of these same highfalutin Greeks. So cause and effect thinking began to invade Christianity. If this, then that. If God gave his law, then he expected it to be kept. If God expected his law to be kept, then keeping the law must save us. Now, we don't want to carry this too far, the ancient church authorities concluded. Otherwise, we'll be teaching that humans can save themselves without the help of Christ or his church, and then we'll have worked ourselves out of a job. Oh, terror! Oh, horror! But still, Christ has done his part. Now you have to do yours. You do good, you get good. You do bad, you get bad. Good behavior gets rewarded. Bad behavior gets punished. Logical, isn't it? So, how's that working out? About as well as it worked for Martin Luther, I'm going to guess. Not well at all. It's like a treadmill. You run, and you run, and you huff, and you puff, and you get nowhere. St. Paul writes, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." How different St. Paul's time is from ours. Greek philosophy is considered an elective subject in schools, where once it was required. Rather than try to discern order in a chaotic world, those who today consider themselves the smartest cookies in the jar embrace the chaos. Well, what else are you going to do when everything dissolves from order to chaos and the form of this world is passing away? From kindergarten to university, we're taught that there is no absolute truth. You decide what's true for you. You're the God of your own land. Who created the Creator? So modern scoffers ask. But still, they hold to the logic of cause and effect. For lack of any better ideas, they still say, you do good, you get good. You do bad, you get bad. Good behavior gets rewarded. Bad behavior gets punished. The highfalutin Greeks had this advantage over our modern smart cookies. They acknowledged that there was such a thing as absolute truth. More importantly, in a world of cause and effect, there is a great uncaused cause. Holy Scripture teaches that the great uncaused cause is God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As he declares through the psalmist, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." St. Paul writes, "But now a righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, though the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Christ Jesus for all who believe." Not long after the Renaissance scholars rediscovered the writings of them highfalutin Greeks, Martin Luther rediscovered the gospel of salvation by God's grace in Christ, which for so long had been buried under a system of rewards and punishments. And what a radical message it is. Salvation and eternal life are not rewards for good behavior. They are gifts given entirely by God's grace. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, though the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. And costly gifts they are too. Purchased and won, as Luther tells us, not with gold or silver, but with Christ's holy precious blood and his innocent suffering and death. As radical a message as the gospel was in Luther's time, it's just as radical today. Oh, we might become blasé about it, because we hear the gospel all the time within these four walls, as well we should. But out in the world, those who are considered the smartest cookies in the jar are still saying, "You do good, you get good. You do bad, you get bad. Good behavior gets rewarded. Bad behavior gets punished." But the apostle writes, "Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith, apart from works of the law." St. Peter writes, "So the honor is for you who believe. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And a stone of stone, and a rock of land. They stumbled because they disobeyed the word, as they were destined to do. On the rock of Christ Jesus, all the smartest cookies crumble. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks. But we preach Christ in him crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and to Gentiles. And I dare say it doesn't make a lot of sense to a lot of 21st century North Americans either." A grandmother was telling her granddaughter about the events of Good Friday. "We have all done wrong," she said, "and deserve to be punished. But Christ took that punishment for us on the cross." The granddaughter thought, "God must be crazy." Yes, indeed, it's crazy. In a world of cause and effect, rewards and punishments, crazy that the innocent should suffer punishment while the guilty get off. It's crazy that the righteous one should die and sinners live. And God must see crazy. Oh, it's crazy, all right. crazy for us. Why would God do such a thing? For one reason only. God loves us like crazy. The apostle writes, this was to show God's righteousness. Because in his divine forbearance, he passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness. One who has faith in Jesus. The people believe it anyway. Believe it when your pastor feeds your sins. Believe it when you receive Christ's body and blood. And don't tell the one who rose from the dead on Easter Sunday what's possible or not. Thank God. God is a contrarian. St. Peter writes, as you come to him, living stone, rejected by men, in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer a spiritual sacrifice to God through Jesus Christ. The psalmist writes, mountains move the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Standing before the emperor and the nobles and the powers of the church and the state at the Diet of Worms, Martin Luther was asked for a candidate. As we know, he replied, unless I am convinced by scripture and plain reason, for I don't trust popes and councils, for they have heard and contradicted themselves. My conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot, will not, can't anything ever. Here I stand. Amen. The form of this world is passing away. The smartest cookies in the jar are crumbling all around. Christ, crucified and risen from the dead, is our mighty fortress. Here we stand. We can do no other. God help us. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son,